Welcome to Excerpts from the Open Forum. On this program, we'll hear Mr. Harold Camping answering pre-recorded questions regarding issues from the Bible. Here's our first question.
Question about the Book of Enoch. Is that a real book from the Bible, or is that a book that you know how it says in Revelation where you cannot add to this book?
The Book of Enoch is something that man has written that has nothing at all to do with the Bible. Nothing at all to do with the Bible. They may claim that it is a part of the Bible, but it is not. And so those who want to claim that it is a part of the Bible indeed are guilty of adding to the Word of God, making the Word of God something more than what it is. But we who have the truth know that it has nothing to do with the Bible.
Oh, thank you very much. And I have one final question about women who are preachers. Isn't that sacrilegious for women to be preachers?
Well, indeed, the Bible says that the women are to be silent. They are not to teach men. And during the church age, which went on for over 1950 years, Bible commanded that a woman was to be silent. All the women were to be silent when the whole congregation came together. Therefore, there was no possibility that a woman could ever have been a preacher. However, we're living in a day when the rules of the Bible are not the authority. Mankind and many churches begin with what they want to pick and choose from the Bible, and then they add to it what they want, and each one does what is right in his own eyes, and that frequently does include the idea, oh, well, our women can be pastors just as well as anybody else. But the whole business is flat rebellion against the Word of God.
Yes, I have a question. Can a saved person have friendships with people who are unsaved?
Well, of course we can have friendship. We live in a world, but we have to be careful that in our friendship with the world, we do not fall into the snares of the world. Now, if you have a friend, for example, who's not saved, he can be your friend, but when he entices you to go to this movie to play this kind of a game or whatever, and it's not God-pleasing, and you say, no, I'm sorry, I have no interest in that, you're going to find he's going to have a hard time remaining a close friend of yours, because he'd like to have a friend that goes along with all of his thinking. And so it's in principle, it's not wrong to have friends in the world, but we have to be very careful.
Okay.
We don't fall into their snares.
Yeah, because I was reading a verse where it says not to be unequal. I'm sorry, you there?
And not to be unequally yoked with an unbeliever.
Yeah, that's what I was wondering, but then I started thinking, how would you tell somebody, you know, politely, well, I can't hang out with you and all that,
Well, we don't.
So maybe the best thing to do is because I get in gospel tracts all the time.
Well, excuse me, you're not unequally yoked with a friend. With a friend, that is something that there is no agreement. There's nothing that ties you together. You can be a friend today, and tomorrow he can decide he doesn't want to be your friend, and so you're not a friend any longer. But when we, for example, talk about the marriage relationship, now we have becoming yoked together with somebody. That is a contract that is absolutely binding, that cannot be broken in any way, because what God has joined together, let not man put asunder. And that's where we have to be super careful if we're planning to marry, that the one we're romancing is, if we're a child of God, that they too are a child of God. Although, by the same token, because there cannot be a separation, if we find after we're married that our spouse is not a child of God and I am a child of God, we are unequally yoked, and life is very difficult consequently, but we cannot separate from that. We have to continue in that situation, and it's going to be a real testing in our life. Can I, in the face of this situation in which I'm in, can I do it God's way, even though it's very, very difficult, because my spouse wants the world and I want Christ, and you have to try to you have to pray again and again for wisdom in order to accomplish that. But that is the most difficult situation for any two people to be in.
Okay. But so anything outside of a marriage, you can remain friends with people as long as you're not doing what they're doing, or you just kind of just walk out of the way when they decide they're going to do something that's contrary to God's word.
Well, as a matter of fact, when we share the gospel, we don't come as aliens with that. We are aliens in that we are citizens of another kingdom, but we come as friends. We come with love in our hearts, with a desire that they too might become saved, but we just be careful that we don't fall into their sins.
My question is, in comparing, there are some passages in the New Testament when an account is given about something and they seem to be not quite saying the exact same thing. And I wanted to just mention one that we might look at and how you might explain that to be reconciled. For example, the account mentioned about Jesus appearing before Pilate in John chapter 18, verse 33, and then in comparison, the same account is mentioned in Luke. Should I tell you the second verse?
Yeah.
Oh, Luke 26, verse 3.
Let's look at that. Luke, let's read these two verses. Luke.
23, excuse me.
23, verse 3. Is that it?
Yes.
23, verse 3. And Pilate asked him, saying, "Art thou the king of the Jews?" And he answered him and said, "Thou sayest it." Now, here in John 18, we read in verse 33, "Then Pilate entered into the judgment hall again and called Jesus and said unto him, 'Art thou the king of the Jews?' Jesus answered him, 'Sayest thou this thing of thyself, or did others tell it thee of me?' Pilate answered, 'Am I a Jew? Thou, thine own nation and the chief priests have delivered thee unto me. What hast thou done?' And then Jesus answered, 'My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, then would my servants fight, that it should not be delivered to the Jews. But now is my kingdom not from hence.' Pilate therefore said unto him, 'Art thou a king then?' Jesus answered, 'Thou sayest, I am a king. To this end was I born, and for this cause came I into the world, that I should bear witness unto the truth.'" Now, you see, what is happening here is that there's a conversation going on between Jesus and Pilate. In the Gospel of Luke, Christ, or the Bible, is just writing down one tiny part of that conversation. Notice that twice in the Gospel of John, the question was raised, "Art thou the king of the Jews, or art thou a king?" And here in Luke, the same question is asked, probably in that conversation. Pilate was groping for some understanding, and he may have asked that question five times, and God only recorded what some of the answers were. But what has been recorded is that part of the conversation that God wanted us to hear. We put the Gospel of Luke part of the conversation together with the Gospel of John conversation, and so we have a little bit larger picture of the whole conversation, although it doesn't necessarily mean that we still have the complete conversation. But we know that God is not contradicting. We know that both of these statements were made exactly the way it's recorded here. But we also know that we're only probably getting a very small part of a longer conversation.
There was a source somewhere, somebody said that perhaps the New Testament is nothing more than a newspaper or like a count of what happened, but it's not inspired, whereas the Old Testament is. And so
that was written, that statement that you are quoting from was written by somebody who has no understanding of what the Bible is. The Bible is the Word of God. When it says in the Gospel of Luke, Jesus said, "Thou sayest," that means that Jesus said, "Thou sayest." When the Bible says in the Gospel of John that Jesus said something else, it means Jesus said whatever that something else is. This is not a summary. This is not some eyewitness that is repeating or summarizing what was going on. If the Bible says it happened exactly this way, it did happen exactly this way. That's because the Bible is the Word of God.
You are listening to excerpts from the Open Forum on Family Radio. Mr. Harold Camping is answering pre-recorded questions about the Bible. If you'd like to hear more of Mr. Camping's teaching, you can hear and even download Open Forum broadcasts, Bible studies, and more. Just go to familyradio.com and click on Audio Archives. Let's continue now with another question.
Yes, hi, Brother Camping. I have a question on Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 13.
Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 13. Let's look at that. Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 13. There we read, "And he declared unto you," now Moses is speaking to Israel at this time. He is reminding them of all what has happened during the past 40 years as they were on their way from Egypt, on their way to the promised land, the land of Canaan, and now they're very close to crossing the Jordan River. And in the process of summarizing and reminding them of what they said, what God said, and so on, he's saying unto them, "He," that is God, "declared unto you his covenant, which he commanded you to perform, even 10 commandments. And he wrote them upon 2 tables of stone. And the Lord commanded me at that time to teach you statutes and judgments, that ye might do them in the land whither ye go over to possess it." Now, what is your question?
Well, the reason I'm calling it, because a couple of weeks back, someone called you and asked you if the Ten Commandments was mentioned anywhere in the Bible, and it says Ten Commandments right here in verse 13.
Oh,
and
yes. I'm sorry. I see your point, and you're correct. In fact, the Ten Commandments are called Ten Commandments in a couple of places in the Bible, and this is one of them, and I thank you for reminding
okay.
us that.
Okay. Were they Moses' commandments, or were they God's commandments?
Oh, they were God's commandments, of course.
So when it says, "And he declared unto you," that's who declared that? God did?
When God declared, we can paraphrase because the context shows this, "And when God declared unto you his," that is God's, "covenant, which he," that is God, "commanded you to perform, Ten Commandments, and he, that is God, wrote them upon two tables of stone.
Yeah. Are we supposed to keep the commandments as believers, I'm saying? Are we supposed to keep them?
Of course. Of course we're supposed to keep. We're supposed to keep the whole law of God.
But it's not like we have to or else, right? It's not like or else. If we don't keep them, God, or we lose our salvation.
Well, now we're talking about something else. You see,
right.
The fact is that God's command is we are to keep all the law of God, not only the Ten Commandments, but everything in the Bible. The Bible is got all kinds of commandments and laws and statutes that we are to keep. And any time we break one of them, any one of them, we are, that means that we have to pay the penalty of damnation. Now, it happens to be that if we truly have become saved, two great things have happened. Number one, when we still commit or break one of those laws, while it is true that we're still subject to damnation because of that, we will not actually come into the damnation because Christ has become our substitute and has already paid the penalty demanded by the law of God because we broke that commandment. But the other thing that happens is that when we have truly become saved, we have been given a brand new resurrected soul in which we have an intense desire to do the will of God. So if we break a commandment of God, we are very unhappy in ourselves. We feel we've violated ourselves because in our new soul existence, we don't want to sin anymore, even though that potential to sin is there and we have to keep our eye on Christ to prevent our bodies, which have not become saved, winning and getting us to fall into a sin.
How you doing? My question was, why cannot Jesus, when he comes, he's coming in the sky, and he's not going to touch the earth, and that's for a certain reason, right?
Well, the Bible doesn't say he won't touch the earth, but the Bible says he will come on the clouds and every eye shall see him, and he has no purpose to touch the earth. The fact is, what is happening at that point, we're right at the end of time, we're in eternity, and I don't know how all that is going to happen at that time. I know all the believers will have been raptured to be with Christ in the air, and then that this whole universe is going to be destroyed by fire. That we know from clear language of the Bible. But insofar as the details of him touching the earth or not touching the earth or anything like that, I don't know anything at all about that.
Okay, my other question was, people say they're born-again Christians. They shouldn't be saying that, like, you know, right?
Well, there's no reason that they can't say that they're a born-again Christian, but the fact that they argue that they are born again does not necessarily mean that they are born again. That doesn't follow at all. Just because we argue that I'm born again, if we truly are saved, we have learned that we have an intense desire to be obedient to the law of God, that can be evidence that we are a child of God, can be the evidence that I have been born again, and we certainly are not prohibited from saying that, but we have to be careful. We don't want to be boastful. It would be better to say by God's mercy, I believe that I am a child of God.
I talk to people, they seem very happy, like it's like nothing, not to worry about it, and protesting you and stuff like that, and I'm just saying, like, I guess God has opened their eyes, right? But It just seems like it's too soft, it's too cozy, you can't get nothing in, and they understand what you're saying, but they don't hear.
Well, that's their problem, and we can't judge them for their problem. They have to answer to God for that. All we can, our role is to look into the mirror, and we're looking at somebody who we have to point the finger at, and that's me, and make sure that I am doing it God's way.
I was wondering, why is it that the Bible or God never teaches us how to actually find a career or, like, you know, jobs in life where we can sustain ourselves?
Well, the question is, here I'm a young man, or maybe an older person, makes no difference, and I want to use my life in a way that is pleasing to the Lord, but I don't know whether I am to become a businessman or a bricklayer or a cook or a school teacher or what. I don't know. Now, it is true that God has designed each human being as a unique person. I would never do as a music teacher. I would never do as a in many areas of life at all, because I have no ability in that direction. There are certain areas where I have certain ability, and that's true of every one of us. One person's ability may be entirely different from all of his friends, and so we tend to try to maximize what is a natural ability that God has given us, if we can utilize that. Maybe we're someone who says, I don't have any particular ability. Well, that's okay. Then we try to get as much training as we can to see if we if there's something that stands out, and we pray for an opening where we can get a job, so that we have to earn a living, we have to take care of our family, we have to take care of ourselves. But through it all, this is the important thing, not finally what is my career, or what kind of career I'm going to have, or how I'm going, what kind of industry or science or social arts or whatever it may be that I get into. That's finally not the important thing. The important thing is, whatever I get into, can I live to the glory of God? That is, I want to work in a way that is pleasing to Him, always with a viewpoint. I want to try to be sure I remain an ambassador for Christ, so that in whatever I'm doing, the grace of God might be seen in my life. I might have opportunity to witness to others. If I am, if I get into a career and I'm earning quite a bit of money, I can use a lot of that to further help send the gospel out into the world. And so it begins with an attitude, oh Lord, whatever it is that you guide me into, and I know I can't be lazy, I know I've got to work trying to get into this area of work or that area of work, but may it be that it will be to thy honor and glory, that I might have my eye always focused on thee. In other words, the first principle is not how much money I can make, or how much security this job is going to give me. Yes, those are all interesting things. But the first principle is, can I take this job, and will I be able to work to His honor and glory? For example, if it is a job that requires me to work on Sunday, and I know that that is a day when I'm to do God's will and not for that which is my own pleasure, I know I can't take that job. That's the end of the matter. Even though it might be a glamorous job, a great opportunity, I can't take that job, because it will cause me to begin to disobey God by working on Sunday. If it is a job, for example, where it's going to end up that I'm going to be a bartender selling intoxicating liquors to people that will be destructive to their life, I know I can't. There's no way that I could take a job like that and believe that I'm living to God's glory. So it means that we have to deny ourselves. We may not obtain what it would be great in the eyes of the world, but we want to get that which is great in the eyes of God. We want to employ ourselves, find opportunity in a way so that we can humbly, very humbly, oh my, humility is the mark of the true believer. We don't have to be a big deal. We don't have to be noticed. We don't have to be recognized. We can walk very humbly as a child of God.